So let us begin this very interesting. In fact, it's another huge topic, which I cannot really do justice to in an hour or an hour and a half. But let me try to give you some idea of how political systems worked in ancient India. It is unfortunate that our history courses at school level do not really carry much information on what was the concept of rulership, governance in ancient India. So this is something which is not studied enough, and which I think could hold a lot of very interesting elements even for the current political situation. And I'll give you a couple of illustrations as we move along. So here you have in this slide a picture of Vaishali, which is in Bihar, northern Bihar. And what you see here is, of course, any student can tell me what this is? What is this? There should be no difficulty in answering. Is this good enough? Can everybody hear me? Okay, so let's keep it like this. So what is this which you see on the image? I'd like a student to answer. You should know this. You see, that is where our history courses are really deficient. So this is a pillar from Ashoka. You know, Ashoka built a lot of pillars across India. I'll come back to that. And it is an emblem of his rule, of his authority, of the empire itself, in fact. So this is why I chose this photo to represent the notion of polity and governance. So let me start first of all with a few definitions, because we have to, you see, the problem is that we talk in English, right? So I'm going to use words like government, like democracy, which have very modern connotations. We have to break away from those and try to now understand the concepts on their own strength in the ancient world, especially ancient India. Okay, this is just a detail. Don't be puzzled, you see a lot of BCE and CE. This means before Common Era or Common Era. This is the now generally used terminology instead of BC and AD, but it is just the same. CE is AD, and etc. Now, ethics, which we will see tomorrow, but there is a reason for introducing it first. What is the Sanskrit word for ethics? There's no real unique Sanskrit word for ethics. It is dharma, of course, broadly, but dharma is much more than ethics. It is also niti, but niti has also other connotations. Or niti shastra, the science of niti. And there are many more words. But again, we will not have an exact match. So as much as possible, we will use the Sanskrit ones. But I just wanted to present them to you. Now, polity, governance, administration. In other words, well, there are plenty. Many, many more than what I present here. Raja Dharma, you can understand, I don't need to explain. Raja Shastra, Rajya is governance, rule, the rule. It's not necessarily by king. Niti Shastra, so begin to see that, you see the terms are common to both. Artha Shastra, now people think that Artha Shastra means economics. No, it doesn't mean, well, strictly speaking it might, because Artha is wealth. So Arthashastra could be translated as the science of wealth, but in actuality, it has a much broader range of meanings, one of which is also governance. Because for a simple reason, without wealth, you cannot have a state and you cannot have a government. So therefore, wealth is the first condition for a healthy rule, a healthy government. Then, danda niti, danda you know, of course. Danda is the stick, the scepter, the emblem of the ruler. In fact, the Ashokan pillar, which you saw on the first slide, is nothing but an enlarged danda, nothing else. It is the same symbol which continues. So, people often translate danda by punishment. This is a, let us say, narrow meaning. It is valid also. But the broad meaning of danda is rule. But rule with authority. That is what it implies. Then Rashtra Tantra doesn't need an explanation. Dharma, Dikara, and so on. There are lots of words, in fact, which can be brought in. So I've been referring to state. Now, a state, we will see later on what definition we have in ancient India for a state. Because the modern definition, according to modern political science, is something completely different. And I won't go into that. I don't feel that, I mean, there are scholars, of course, who will compare the ancient notions with the new ones. But first of all, I'm not competent to do that because I don't know modern political history. And secondly, it is equally valid to look at these concepts on their own strength, in their own context, without reference to the modern context. In fact, I believe it should be the first approach always. We should do any comparison only later once we have understood properly, you know, those concepts on their own strength. So state or territory, because the two go together, you can't have a state without territory. So the two notions are very intimately linked. Desha, Kshetra, Rajya, Rashtra. Mandala, Janapada. Janapada is very important and we'll return to that. Chakra, for a reason which we will see, and Varsha, and so on. So there's a very rich vocabulary. What does, first of all this vocabulary tell us? It tells us that there are varieties of concepts at work, and therefore these notions are not primitive, they are not rudimentary, they are not tribal concepts, they are already quite elaborate. Otherwise you would not need such a rich vocabulary. Now my next definition is India. We're going to talk about India. What is India? What is India? How do you define India? Now you see, in the colonial period, the second should not have come. Anyway, in the colonial period, the British were fond of saying, and many British historians said that, you know, it was the British who created India as a nation. Okay? You might have heard this. Sometimes it is there even in our textbooks. I've seen it. And in a sense, it is not wrong. If you understand nation, India as a nation, in the modern sense of a nation. The modern sense of a nation is a fixed territory with defined borders, with a defined constitution, whether written or not is another issue, and a defined political system, whether you have presidential system, Westminster, you know, etc., etc. So this is the concept of a nation today, and it is basically a European concept. That concept does not exist in the ancient world. Something else exists, which I will try to define a little bit as I proceed. So in a way, this is correct if you take the modern definition of a nation. But if you take the ancient concept of a state, it is of course a wrong statement. And it cannot stand any scrutiny. And we will come back to this a little later. So there are many ways to define India. The first way and the easiest is geographical. You simply say that India is the Indian subcontinent. Okay? The Indian subcontinent, which of course would include what is today Pakistan, Bangladesh, and so on. This is a simple definition for India. But how did India define itself is a more interesting question, geographically. So there are many terms. Aryavarta, which initially is actually a very small region. The original Aryavarta is a region defined as between being the Sarasvati and the Drishadvati, which are two rivers which used to flow through Haryana, Punjab, and so on. Then it grew, it became enlarged, and it was defined in various texts as Bharata, Bharatvarsha, and Jambudvipa. So Jambudvipa ends up being the entire subcontinent, because India is understood to be some kind of an island, Dvipa. It is surrounded by the oceans. Of course, it's not an island, but you know, definitions are somewhat fluid, not very strict always. But for example, Vishnu Purana, which is one of the oldest Puranas, now oldest, what does it mean? It's hard to say, but certainly the Gupta age, 4th, 5th, 6th century AD or CE, possibly even older than that, we don't know. Defined very clearly, it says the country that lies north of the ocean And south of these snowy mountains, the Himalayas, is called Bharata. So there is a concept. It cannot be denied that there is a concept of this geographical entity. But it's not just geographical, it is cultural. There is a cultural entity recognizable as such, which is called Bharata, which today is called India, and which had a geography. I call it sacred geography. I will not go into this today simply because it is populated by Hinduism, Buddhism, Jainism, and other sects, some of which have disappeared since then. And they have put their landmarks everywhere. You know, the networks of tirthas, the networks of pilgrimage. This is a very interesting topic in itself, which helps define India in a very concrete manner. So there is a cultural integration to which I will return once or twice in the course of this talk. And that is why, if you take these two together, the geographical entity and the cultural entity, that is why all travelers to India, whether they were Greeks, Romans, Chinese, Arabs, etc., understood India to be one India. So when, for example, the Greeks speak about India, which they call Indica, it is India. So of course, the Greeks knew only northern India. It is true that they didn't seem to be aware of South India. The Romans were very much aware of South India, and they were trading with South India a lot. So when you read those sources, for them, India is India. So whatever name they use, the Arabs, for example, will call India Hind. If you look at a text of mathematics, very important text of mathematics by Al-Khwarizmi, who was a Central Asian mathematician who worked in Baghdad in the 9th century CE, well, Al-Khwarizmi wrote, among the various books he wrote, one was Hisab al-Hind, which means mathematics from India. So there is no doubt in these people's minds that India exists. You can't say that it does not exist. If it exists, it is partly geographical, but also very much cultural, culturally identifiable. So these are my definitions. And now we have a quick look at a little bit of historical background, because we should understand that we need to have a historical perspective. Some people tackle the issue of governance and administration exclusively with the texts. For example, you have in Mahabharata a very long discussion between Bhishma and Yudhishthira. When Bhishma is lying on his bed of arrows, you know the story, I will not repeat. Before dying, he wants to pass on his knowledge of governance to Yudhishthira. So there's a very long discussion on the duties of the king, and his relation with the subjects, and how he should rule, and what is justice, what is dharma, and this and that, and so on, and it goes on and on. It's actually quite a small book in itself. So this is very interesting, and it gives us a lot of reference points, but we can also not take it as something historical. We can't, you know, put a date on it, and we can also not say where this was put into application. So we have to look at both. And therefore, a historical perspective is required. Now, I start, in fact, with a proto-historical perspective simply to ask one question, which archaeologists have been asking. What type of government did the Indus civilization have? This is a question that comes often. You must have been exposed, most of you, either through lectures of mine or maybe in the course of Dr. Prabhakar or other courses here, you must have been exposed a little bit to the Indus civilization. And the fact is that there was a huge 1 million square kilometers, huge expanse, the whole northwest of India was populated by this civilization. And the beauty is that we don't even know who were the rulers. We don't know at all. We cannot put a name on the rulers, and we cannot easily determine the kind of government that was there. Initially, Mohenjo-daro was, because it is so huge, was thought to be the capital of the Harappan Empire. But this thinking and some buildings like this one, which is a huge pillared hall, sometimes called assembly hall in some of the maps. This is brought as evidence that they were places for people to meet. So it's quite possible that people were meeting in such halls, but in what context, we cannot say. Was it really a king presiding over representatives of the people? It's just impossible to tell. There is another line which has been more recently followed, which is that it could not have been a single empire because it was too big. This Harappan or Indus civilization is bigger than ancient Egypt and Mesopotamia put together. Ancient Egypt and Mesopotamia were contemporary with this civilization. So how could you govern it? How could you impose the same norms of weight and brick sizes or proportions and pottery shapes and designs and so on and so forth? All this kind of standardization of the Indus civilization, how could you take care of it over such a huge region with just the bullock cart and maybe some river boats? So the thinking is that because there are certain slight differences also between all these regions, I won't go into detail, it was perhaps loosely a kind of confederation of city-states. Now, a city-state, what is a city-state? The model for city-states is, of course, ancient Greece, when you have Athens, you have Sparta, and you had more small states, which were actually independent republics, but united by a common language and a common culture. So this is one favored hypothesis at the moment, but the evidence ultimately for the precise type of government is weak. So we have to keep this as a question mark. Now, when we move to the Vedic age, now whether I will not go into the question of the date of the Vedic age, whether it was pre-Harappan at the same time as the Harappan civilization or later on, doesn't matter. That's not our point today. But Vedic age broadly covers the age of the Veda Samhitas, the four Vedas, and the subsequent literature in the form of the Brahmanas and the Upanishads. This is broadly what is called the Vedic age. Once we enter the age of the Dharma Shastras, we are no longer quite in the Vedic age. Anyway, what's very interesting is that this Rig Veda is the first text we have in India, the very first. Again, its date is controversial. The most conservative date will be about 1500 BC, but there are scholars who propose much older dates than that. Whatever the date may be, this is in a way the beginning of India. And we see a number of interesting things which actually are going to be amplified later on. So first of all, there is a notion of a king. And the gods, most of the powerful gods of the Rig Veda, like Agni, Indra, Surya, and so on, are called often king. They are called Raja, or various other terms which mean the same. However, there are kings also. There are also human kings. But the human kings are not, it doesn't work both ways. They are not deified. They are not regarded as divine. They are very much human. There's no doubt about that. But it has a certain number of words like Raja, Adhiraja, that is the supreme ruler. Samraj is also another type of universal ruler. So, you know, people say, for example, that the Rig Veda is a tribal society. Some scholars say that. You will see that in some texts, even textbooks of history. Though there is a lot of evidence against that, but without going into detail, the point here is that why do they need so many words, and there will be many more coming up even in the Atharva Veda. Why do they need so many words, and especially words like Samraj, if they are actually in a tribal society? So this point is important, and apart from this, there are words like Sabha and Samiti, so which seem to refer to a social organization.
So these words, am I audible? Yeah. Seem to refer to a fairly elaborate system. Sabha, of course, can just be a meeting ground for people, nothing much more. But There are lots of references to it in contexts which indicate a certain amount of complexity. So was it a tribal system of chieftains, as some scholars would want it, or is there something already more elaborate, is the question. We have references to the king having to visit his samiti. So the assembly, if you like, is something that the king has to consult. This is clear in some passages. In the Atharva Veda, which is the last of the four Vedas, Rig Veda is the first. Atharva Veda, you have even a prayer for the samiti to be always in agreement with the king. And you see, you have a ruler and you have an assembly. The assembly debates, discusses. Okay? There are problems in the society. And sometimes there will be a difference. There will be differences of opinion. So here we see this germ of difference of opinion and the need to reach a consensus. There is even evidence of election. And this is something very important because I will explain why in the next few slides. For example, Atharva Veda says the people elect you, it is addressed to the king. The people elect you to rulership, the wide glorious quarters elect you. Be seated on this high point in the body of the state, and from there vigorously distribute the natural wealth. Natural wealth refers to harvests and such things, which is the wealth in those days, and which has to be distributed among the people. So, but the people choose you. You see, there is this notion that the king is elected, and that's important to keep in mind. Finally, there's no evidence that the king has got absolute power. In fact, very rarely in India will there be monarchs wielding absolute power. Usually, the concept is that they are always answerable to the assembly and ultimately answerable to the people. In actual practice, of course, there will be some who will aspire to be absolute monarchs, but the concept is against that. Now, when we reach what is called the early historical age, broadly speaking, it means first millennium BC. Broadly speaking, the Vedic age is second or older than that, millennium BC, and we are now in the first millennium BC when all these states are going to take shape. Now, first of all, a quick look at some of the innovation. We are in the Iron Age, while the Harappan civilization was in the Bronze Age. And we see the emergence of organized states all over, especially North India, from the Indus Plains to the Ganges Plains, and Central India and Eastern India. Lots of states come up, and I will show you some of them very soon. The emergence also of organized religions, Buddhism, Jainism in particular, and other sects which have disappeared since. Codification of the late, of the belief and thought systems of the late Vedic era. What does this mean? It means that the Vedic religion gets transformed into philosophical systems and thought systems, some of which we will see with Professor Vianchan. And then we move also from the Upanishads to the Dharma Shastras and various other Shastras. So there's a great shift taking place during the early historical era. At the same time, there's also a continuity. It is change and continuity. There's a huge literary production, enormous number of texts, some of which today we would call Hindu texts, but Buddhist literature also is immense. Jain literature is immense, and so there's a considerable intellectual activity. With or without writing, please note. This is, for example, if you take Panini belongs to this era, the great Indian grammarian. Panini composed his grammar of Sanskrit, which kind of fixed the perfection of Sanskrit. It is Ashtadhyayi, as some of you would know, but he composed it in his mind. It was initially orally transmitted. That's why the sutras were very brief. So it was something meant to be learned by heart. Later on, more and more texts will be put into writing. But initially, Of course, the Vedas themselves, but even technical texts like Panini's grammar will be orally transmitted for a while. A huge amount of artistic production, which will lay the foundations for classical Indian art, and interactions between India and other cultures and civilization. Of course, that started in the 3rd millennium BC with the Harappans. The Harappans, you might know, were traveling to distant regions like all the way to Mesopotamia and Central Asia. But during the 2nd millennium BC, after the collapse of the Harappan civilization, all these distant trade networks disappeared. So they are going to be slowly rebuilt during the 1st millennium BC. And there will be some innovations, for example, the invention of currency. The Harappans did not have currency. So it was barter trade. They were taking goods out, like jewelry, like timber, perhaps metal objects and so on, but they were bringing back other things, which actually we don't know much about. Anyway, so currency now is invented. And then, one major innovation is war. War, I say innovation because there is absolutely no trace of war in the Indus civilization. It just doesn't seem to exist. The Harappans were primarily traders. There is no trace whatsoever of an organized army, a military order, barracks, weapons of war, depictions of warfare. None of this exists in the Indus civilization. So in a way, it's a very interesting civilization because it appears to be broadly peaceful, at least in its relation with other cultures. But here, in the early historical era, warfare becomes not only widespread, it's an integral part of what a king is supposed to be doing, you see. I won't say it's a duty of the king to wage war, that would be extreme, but it's a normal occupation, and all Indian kingdoms are going to be constantly at war. I won't say with each other, that would be too much, but there's a huge amount of warfare happening. So this warfare will have, of course, negative aspects, a lot of destruction, loss of lives, and so on, but it will also have positive aspects, one of which is going to integrate India further. Apart from the cultural integration, which I briefly referred to earlier, we're going to have a military integration of India, and I'm going to explain that very shortly. Now, first of all, again, sometime in this period, let's just look at a text like Mahabharata. Now, Mahabharata is not a text of history. It is a story. That's different, okay? It tells a story. Whether that story ever happened or not, nobody can prove or disprove. It's a matter of belief at the end of the day, and it doesn't really matter. We cannot prove, you know, that the Pandavas existed and waged war against the Kauravas. There's no independent evidence. So you believe or you don't believe, and that's the end of it. However, the Mahabharata is written in a certain context. And that context is precise. And the context was that, suppose you are a novelist and you write a novel today in modern Ahmedabad, you use a certain setting. Okay, your story may be completely fictitious. I'm not saying that Mahabharata is fictitious, I just don't know. But the setting which you choose is going to have certain elements, you know, which can be studied in modern literature or even ancient literature. People do that all the time. So here what we see is that there is a context. Because there's a great war, that great war involves the whole of Bharat. And we have all these kingdoms. You can read a few names, some of which will be familiar to you. All over the map, like Magadha, like you will have Vang, which becomes Bangla, etc. So, and the Cholas and Pandyas and Kevas are also mentioned in Mahabharata. So the whole map is filled with kingdoms which are meticulously listed not once but two, three times throughout the text. And therefore, first of all, people always forget that, therefore we can date that city. That setting is the second half of the first millennium BC, a few centuries BC. or AD. Because if you want to go further back in time, then these will not exist. The South Indian kingdoms begin possibly around 400 BC, not earlier. So we can date that city. And secondly, it tells us that there is now this political system of kingdom in place all over India. And therefore, there has been, at this stage, there is a political integration in the fact that all these kingdoms follow certain similar patterns, which I will now go into a little further in detail. Well, this is well known. I don't have to spend time on this. Very complex and mixed society, which are reflected in Mahabharata. Incidentally, not only kingdoms, there are peoples. They are called Janas. They are called various names. They are listed alongside those kingdoms. And Mahabharata takes great pains to give us a good ethnographic map of India, as it is called. 363 peoples. Ethnic groups are listed in the text. It wants us to understand the complexity and totality of India. So this is quite interesting. They are usually called Jana, sometimes Jatis. But Jati is usually a kind of a subunit. The definitions are a little bit fluid. Very interesting, from a social point of view, Mahabharata speaks a lot about tribal groups. I mean, they are identifiable in this list. But tribal groups are simply people who live in different environments. That's all. That is the only difference. There are people who live in the mountains. There are people who live in the desert. There are people who live by the, sometimes by the sea, etc. So that is how you make out. Otherwise, Mahabharata does not distinguish between so-called tribal groups and the mainstream society. And this is very important, because this concept of tribe is actually a colonial concept brought in by colonial anthropology of the 19th century. And you know which initially painted tribals as primitive people, savages, and so on. Of course, these notions have changed slightly, but there's still a little baggage attached to the word tribe or tribal. And it's interesting that Mahabharata does not make that distinction, does not regard tribals are particularly primitive or savage. In fact, the great anthropologist K.S. Singh, who was the Director General of the Anthropological Survey of India for quite a while, and he was the one who edited this 11-volume massive collection called The People of India. And he wrote, he studied this ethnography in Mahabharata quite a bit, and he said there's no evidence to show that in the collective consciousness of India, real ancient India, there is any difference between the two sets of Janas. That is to say, the Janas who live in the cities and the Janas who live in. Even today, I don't know in Hindi. In fact, how do you say tribe in Hindi? What would be the word for tribe? Tribal people? No, this is a recent term coined in the 19th century by British anthropologists. There has to be some other word. In Tamil, for example, we say Malai Makkal. That is to say, people of the mountain. That's all. These are tribes. People of the mountain. It's exactly the spirit of Mahabharata. Upa
Jati.
Upa Jati. Possibly. Well, that's an interesting topic of debate.
Upa Jati is sub tribe. I mean, sub caste.
Yes.
No, but at that point of time, there was, as you said, there was no caste of the thing. So, Jati, Upa Jati was
the language. Well, it would be an interesting little subject of research. We could look into that. There has to be, let's say, you know, if we take Tulsidas Ramayana, you know, we could look into what kind of Hindi words he uses. Anyway, so this is a side remark. So what is this Jana? Jana is a collection of people, a group of people, but people who can also form a state together. And therefore, Janapada. Therefore, Janapada. So, Jati is usually, as I said, a segment of the, for example, one Jana of Kiratas have several jatis as constituent groups. So it is complex, but the broad notions are quite clear. There is also the notion of gana. Gana in Mahabharata, you know what gana means, you know, for example, Ganapati. Gana is again a multitude. It's a sense of a multitude of people. So in Mahabharata, gana is a republican kind of slip. What is republican? I'm coming to that right now. But this is the meaning. And sangha. Now it's interesting because we will see that the concept of sangha is very strong in the Buddhist view of things. But it is also very much in Mahabharata. Now is Mahabharata pre-Buddhistic, post-Buddhistic? That's another big question. I won't go into that. So a sangha is actually a confederation of gana. And you see, again, Mahabharata is not a historical text, but nevertheless, it would not be using those notions in the volume. They have to have been in use in the setting of those days. Right. Now we come back to a little bit of history, but you don't have to worry about dates, about names of dynasties and all that. That's not at all my approach. This is not a class of history. It's just to situate things a little bit. And when we enter this early historical era of the first millennium BC, the first thing we can distinguish on the land as political structures are known as the 16 Mahajanapadas of the Buddhist era. But it is wrong to say the Buddhist era, because the Buddhist era is also a Hindu era, is also a Jain era. There's no, it is all of it together. However, this is the time when Buddhism emerges, which is why people, and they are very often frequently mentioned in Buddhist literature, but also in other texts. So anyway, what are those Mahajanapadas? So they are the first political entity. Before them, there is no way, in the first millennium BC, for example, there must have been political entities. We know nothing in the second millennium BC, I'm sorry. Second millennium BC, there must have been political entities, but we know nothing about them, absolutely nothing. So here now, in the literature, and you can easily recognize some of those names, in this literature, in the literature, also in Panini in fact, speaks of the Janapadas, and I believe it is Patanjali who gives this list also. There are 16 states, 16 Mahajanapadas. What exactly are those Mahajanapadas? They are also called proto-republics of ancient India. Why so? It is not that there was no king, there was a king, always, but he was answerable to a system of assemblies. Which started from the village level all the way up to the king. And in fact, in at least two of them, the king was not even hereditary, he was elected. At least two Mahajanapadas elected their king. And I will show you one example, and there's something a little ironic about it. And so, this is a very something which seems to be much rooted in what we saw in the Rig Veda, this concept of Raja, but the assembly, and they have to be in consensus, and the Raja must visit his assembly often. This seems to be rooted in that. At least there is some connection. So this is how the story begins from a historical point of view. And well, all the evidence we have is that there was actual representation. Now, if there is representation, then we can speak of democracy. Democracy, of course, not in the modern sense of the term, but in the rule sense of the term. What is democracy? Demo is people, democracy is rule, it is the rule of the people. In a true democracy, like for example in ancient Greece, classical Greece, there was democracy because there were parliaments and people could go and speak. Parliament means parlier, it's from a French Latin root. It's a place where you speak. Parler is parler in French. It means to speak. So it's a place where your voice can be heard. If your voice cannot be heard, there's no democracy. It may be called a democracy, but if the common man cannot, through a certain network of assemblies, cannot have a say in the rule, then there is no democracy. So So there seems to be, and I'll return to this concept of democracy. For example, the Chinese, which again the capital was Vaishali, which I showed you on the first slide, according to one Buddhist text, has 7,707 members. That seems to be a little too much to my mind. I think this is a literally exaggeration, probably, because an assembly of 7,000 people is going to be. But the what is interesting is that the technical term for them, you know, what we call today members of parliament, for example, MPs, technical term is Rajas. They're called Rajas. So therefore, what is Raja? Raja is not a king. Raja, strictly speaking, means a ruler. You see? So they are the rulers. And another one is supposed to have had 5,000 members, whatever. So some of them were without a hereditary ruler, but even when the king was hereditary, not elected, but from father to son, even then they were answerable to the assembly. The assembly had a strong power. Now, the problem which comes with such a system, and that is why it is not going to last. We will see the fall of the system very soon. In a couple of slides, it will just disappear. But it will not completely disappear. Some democratic notions will remain. Because the minute you allow all these representatives to talk and discuss and take decisions, you're going to have, well, whatever ailments we are too familiar with in our own democracy, whatever we see happening, you know, in the Lok Sabha, you're going to have groupism, you're going to have people lobbying, you're going to have a lot of shouting, you're going to have, you know, disagreements, and so on. I don't know whether they had walkouts, but quite possibly. Anyway, the point is it will introduce a measure of instability. If you have a very strong king and a weak assembly, you will have more stability. Of course, all depends in that case whether the king is enlightened or not. So, for example, there is a very interesting little passage in the Lalita Vistara, which is a text on the life of the Buddha. Slightly late text. Not from the time of the Buddha, of course. It must be a couple of centuries. And, you know, there is always the concept of the future Buddha in Buddhism, the Bodhisattva, the being who is on the verge, who is going to become the Buddha in the next birth. Now, he sits in heaven, he's going to take birth. And he sits in heaven, and he's wondering about his next birth. All right? And then the question is, where should he be born? In which family should he be born? And there is a discussion going on. The other Bodhisattvas and the gods discuss. And somebody proposed the Chavisa Vaishali, you know, the same Mahajanapada I was referring to. And but then most others disagree. They say, look, and please remember we are in a context of parliament with a multitude of members of parliament. And apparently with the elected king. And he says, look, these people do not speak to each other in a proper manner. That is to say, they use unparliamentary language, as we say today. They do not follow the dharma. They do not preserve the ranks of social status and age. They do not become anybody's disciples. That is to say, they have no regard for their gurus. And each one thinks, I am Raja, I am Raja. It's a pun, you see. I am the king, I am the king. Actually, Raja here just means a member of parliament. But here the two concepts are fused together. So this is how they poke fun at this institution, which was nevertheless a very daring innovation of a democratic institution. But then the defects of it are also glaring, and we can almost recognize all of them in our context even today. So then, there are other democratic institutions. Now this will disappear. The Mahajanapadas are going to disappear. I will come back to this a little later. However, this habit, or let us say this demand for democratic institutions in India is going to remain very strong throughout its history, and to manifest itself at a number of different levels. So, for example, the Buddhist Sangha. You know what is the Buddhist Sangha? It is basically the monastic order, which was the backbone of Buddhism, right? The monks, the nuns also, and the fact that it was what really propagated Buddhism, ensured its teaching, ran a number of education institutions all the way to the famous Nalanda and so on. So this Sangha was a democratic institution, and there were systems of votes, quorums, you know, minimum number of members to be present at meetings. It was not something that was ruled by some kind of pope in an absolute manner. Even in Nalanda University, there is on record, this is the Chinese pilgrims who visited Nalanda say so. The decisions were taken mostly by votes. And the students even had a student body in Nalanda. There was a student body, and they participated in meetings and in decision making. So this is we could call it loosely democratic institution. Then the very important institution of Shreni. I don't have too much time, unfortunately, to discuss expound it. But it is of great importance, because it is something that will impact the way business and trade and craft is going to be conducted in India. So the Shreni is a guild. What is a guild? It is a corporate group of craftsmen and all traders coming together. You see, I'm an individual trader, you are an individual trader. We're going to compete, we're going to waste a lot of time, and we actually are covering the same market, we're covering the same resources. Why don't we come together? And let's do business together. Instead of being competitors, we can be collaborators. And we will share the resources, we will share. So, of course, there has to be some decision making at the top. And the head of the guild, so there were many guilds for all kinds of, for each trade almost. There was or could be a different guild. So you could have a guild for jewelers, for builders, for those who traded outside of India, and so on. So the headman was elected, but if he was not competent, he could be removed. And the office bearers, executive officers, if you like, would also be elected, and there were certain conditions which are important, because those conditions are repeated in a number of different contexts, and I will show you one more a little later. These conditions was that they had to be well versed in the Vedas. But Veda doesn't mean the four Vedas. Veda, usually in ancient India, when you see it in such context, is a very loose term that can go all the way to the Dharma Shastras. It means basically the Vedic corpus. They had to be not greedy, because otherwise they'll be dishonest, of noble ancestry, proficient in their craft, of course, they should be competent, and neither too old nor too young, and there are many more conditions. So this was to ensure the honesty, transparency, and efficiency of the running of the guilds. In fact, they are mentioned in various literatures, even the Jatakas, refer to the guilds, and they list 18 guilds. So, in one Dharma Sutra, Dharma Sutras are the fundamental texts of Dharma Shastras. Dharma Shastra is, let us say, a whole area of codification of not only the law. People often translate Dharma Shastra or Dharma Sutra as the laws of ancient India. It's not just law, it is the whole guideline, the whole conduct of the society. So we try to, these Dharma Sutras, and there are many of them, were works which try to, for example, Manusmriti is among the, you know, it's one of the more famous for the wrong reasons, in fact. It's part of the Dharma Sutras. And it tries to set down standards, codes, and possibly laws. But the laws cannot be imposed by Matan. The laws will have to be ultimately imposed by the king or by the society. So they are guidelines. And one of them, this Gautama Dharma Sutra, states that cultivators, traders, herdsmen, moneylenders, and artisans have authority to lay down rules for their respective classes. This is very important. What it says is that every community, especially the productive communities, okay, who are usually organized, who are usually the same that are organized in guilds, those communities have a right to dictate their own rules and laws as far as they are concerned. Of course, not as far as others are concerned. But they can run their own affairs, and a king is not to intervene. This is extremely important, and we have a lot of historical evidence to confirm it, that there is this strong tendency in Indian society towards self-government. It wants to rule itself as much as possible. And that is why the village, for example, will become the smallest unit of self-government. It will, most villages will be completely self-ruled. So the king, it doesn't have, again, absolute power. It is not supposed to mess up with the way the society is running. If the society is running satisfactorily, it's not supposed to intervene at all. And to dictate, you know, to people how they should run their lives and how they should run their communities, and especially how they should run their occupations, professional occupations, it's not supposed to, the king is not supposed to intervene. This is very interesting. And the panchayat system, you've heard of it, but what we call today panchayat has very little to do with the ancient panchayat system, which is explained in a number of texts and inscriptions, and which was this self-government that I was referring to. So you can see altogether that this sense of democracy is an aspiration in the Indian people, which manifests itself in many ways, at different times and at different places. And that is why the Canadian historian Steve Mulberger, who studied, he produced a brilliant paper. In fact, we will share this paper as part of this class, and the students will have to read it. I think it may be the one paper that we need for this class. Steve Mulberger wrote, "The experience of ancient India with republicanism is better known, would by itself make democracy seem less of a freakish development. Because there is a notion that democracy does not exist in the ancient world." You see, it's a wrong notion. "And hence dispel the common idea that the very concept of democracy is specifically Western. It's especially remarkable that during the near millennium, from 500 BC, this is what I call the early historical period, and 400 AD, which is the Gupta age, the age of the Gupta Empire, we find republics almost anywhere in India that our sources allow us to examine society in any detail." Republics, he says. Republic in an Indian sense of the term, not republic in a modern sense of the term, of course not. "The republics of India were likely more extensive and populous than the polis of the Greeks. The polis are those city-states which I was referring to." Polis means a city, in fact. You know, Acropolis, for example, when we speak of Acropolis, it is the same word. So polis is a city, it's a city-state in that sense. "The existence of Indian republicanism is a discovery of the 20th century. The implications of this phenomenon have yet to be fully digested. Historians may find in the Indian past, as elsewhere, plenty of raw material for a new history of the development of human government." So this is the assessment of a Canadian historian looking at the Indian material. Now let me continue, giving an example from a much later period in South India. And this is in Uttara Verur, under the Cholas. Now the Cholas were powerful kings. They were very authoritarian. And you can't say that, you know, the Chola kingdom was a republic. Normally you would not be able to say that. Because it was ruled with great authority. And yet, we know from this village of Uttara Verur, not very far from Kanchipuram, in Tamil Nadu, and where there are very long inscriptions on how the Chola administration was running, we know that there existed a whole system of assemblies, starting right from the village level all the way to the king's level. So this is exactly what the same spirit as what we saw in northern India. And that's why I'm taking now an example from South India to show you that this spirit was common to the whole of India. So in village assemblies, for example, very strict conditions, demanding conditions, qualifications as well as disqualifications were listed for the candidates. And the selection of the candidates to this assembly was not exactly an election. How it happened briefly is that all the names of the candidates after screening, after we were sure that they were fulfilling the qualifications and not the disqualifications which I'm going to show you, the names were written on pieces of paper or palm leaf or whatever it may have been and kept in a pot. And a small child from the village was called and was extracting the names from that pot. And this was how the assembly was constituted. So in other words, favoritism, you know, was ruled out. Nobody was taking a decision as to who would eventually be selected. So qualifications, there's a very long list. I am only selecting a few items. First of all, knowledge of some Vedic texts, exactly what we saw for the office bearers of the guilds. A knowledge of the Vedic texts, which means basically usually the Shastras, the Dharma Shastras. Ownership of tax-paying land and of a house. That means the candidate must not be a poor person. He must have enough wealth not to be tempted by, you know, by corruption. And taxpaying, ensuring that he is an honest candidate. He has not been cheating the village by not paying his taxes. These are the age limits. Again, the guilds were telling us, neither too old nor too young. Too old is a problem, and we know very well in modern India what happens when we have, you know, 80 plus MPs. It doesn't work. And too young also is going to be a problem because you would have immaturity, you know. So you see how they have thought it out quite carefully. He who possesses, this is an actual quotation, honest earnings, whose mind is pure, and who has not been on any of the committees for the last 3 years. What are these committees? They are the village committees. In the village, which is again is a unit of self-government, all major tasks are run by specific committees. Suppose you have water conservation, or you have farming, or you have construction, whatever, there will be a particular committee appointed to look after this. And this committee will have funds, because for example, the committee may have to construct a dam, may have to construct something, so they have funds which are collected from among all the communities. And they have, so therefore these are influential people. This condition ensures that there are no vested interests. Because if you have a committee member who's going to be on a village, in the assembly at the same time, there will be a dual interest and he's going to lobby all the time for his committee and not for other causes. So this takes care of this problem. You see how carefully they have thought it out. There are many disqualifications, lots of them. But anyway, one who has been on any of the committees but has not submitted his accounts. So even after 3 years, of having been on a committee, if you fail to submit the committee's account properly to the village, then you will be disqualified. One who has stolen the property of another, well, that's pretty plain. And relatives of a candidate cannot be candidates. You know, we talk all the time of, what is it, nepotism in contemporary India. So no nepotism, right? So you can see that this, again, Chola kingdom is not a democracy by modern standards. It doesn't qualify. But at the level of the village and higher levels also, it qualifies because a number of steps are ensured from the transparency of the representative system. Right. Now, I'll take a quick look, it's already 14, that's okay. I'll take a quick look at the what happens at the level of the major political units in India in the first millennium BC and first millennium AD. I'm coming to a certain point here which is important. I'm not giving you, again, a class of history, but you can just broadly understand what we are talking about. First of all, these are, in the North India, these are all the important cities, which are, some of which are the capitals of those Mahajanapadas, like, for example, Rajgir, like Vaishali, and so many others. So this is just to show you the map, but it doesn't, it should not be limited to North India. In South India also, there are important cities which have been explored, and Central India and Eastern India. So we have an India which is quite densely networked with kingdoms and communities. And there are many powerful symbols of those kingdoms, the states. Some are very visible, for example, the Ashokan pillars. Others are less visible. For example, these ramparts, I showed you this slide already in the class on civic architecture. To be able to erect such a rampart, like for example, this is from Kaushambi, to erect such a rampart, you need to be able to control manpower in a big way. It has been calculated that erecting such ramparts all around a city like Kaushambi, and Mathura, for example, has even bigger ramparts. The ramparts in Mathura were something like 33 meters broad, the thickness of the ramparts. Why did they need such thick ramparts is another matter altogether. But it would mean controlling thousands of workers for months together. So therefore, you cannot erect such fortifications without a substantial amount of power and control over the people. The Mahajanapadas, for some reason, collapse. They just go one by one. Actually, they get, rather than growing or collapsing, it would be more accurate to say that they get swallowed into bigger units. What are those bigger units? They are kingdoms. Where we go now to a monarchical system, where the king is hereditary, and where he has more authority than the king of the Mahajanapadas, who were more or less a kind of a figurehead. So here, the first kingdom in India that can be safely identified is Magadha. And it coincides broadly with the parts of much of Bihar and parts of Orissa and Bengal. So this is from the 6th century BC, and the capital was Rajgir, or Rajagriha. Of ancient times. Now you see what happens at this, we have to keep in mind, because I'm talking about India. But India is constantly in touch with other political entities. And the first major brush with a huge political entity is that with the Persian Empire in the 5th century BC, where the Persians, and you can see in pink the extent of the empire, so I'm not going to comment on that, actually enter India, and they conquer half of the Indus Valley. And they set up cities or rebuild or expand existing cities. And this has a great importance because certain concepts are going to travel. So I mention this because some people say, for example, well, India got its democratic concepts from Persia or from later Greece. But, you know, things travel in both directions, and ultimately, at the end of the day, it's very difficult to decide. But it's not very surprising if we can find certain commonalities, whatever the direction may have been. Then we have this Magadha becomes swallowed into the first empire of ancient India, which is the Nanda Empire. So we can talk now of empire because an empire is several kingdoms concur and integrated. So this is more than a kingdom. And the capital was still at Pataliputra, which coincides with modern Patna. So this will go on till 321 BC. And why do I mention the date? Because 2 years earlier, something happens, and this is the conquest, or rather, 2 years later, I think. This is the conquest of, again, the same section of the Indus Valley, which was conquered by the Persian Empire, and this time by Alexander the Great. What Alexander does is basically to reconquer the whole of the Persian Empire, all the way into India. So then there will be a lot of interaction, and though he decides to stop at a certain point, actually his army was exhausted and refused to extend it. Alexander himself wanted to go and try to conquer the Nanda Empire, but his army refused. They were exhausted, and they said, no, we will regret if you do that. And we have been told that the Nanda Empire is extremely powerful and has huge armies of elephants and whatnot, so we will not go into that campaign. And Alexander was forced to retreat and died very soon afterwards, a couple of years after, I think, and his empire immediately disintegrated. You see, those huge empires are very difficult to hold together for a long period of time. So what happened is that the Mauryan Empire took over. Mauryan Empire, which took over from the Nanda Empire, this is phase one. Then phase two, phase three, it reconquers the territories conquered by Alexander, and then it expands to the south, but it stops here. The Mauryan Empire, which is the largest political entity that ever ruled India, that is what I wanted to bring you to this point. This is, in blue, the Mauryan Empire. So you can see that it is much larger than today's India. It included Pakistan, it included Afghanistan, it included much of what is today Bangladesh, even a little bit possibly of what is today Burma. But it did not include the south, Tamil Nadu, Kerala. Though it knew about it, and Ashoka the Great writes about the southern kingdoms, it did not try to extend to that level for whatever reasons. So this is to show you two things, which are important if we want to understand the political history of India. First, there was a desire to integrate the totality of India politically and create not only, as I said at the beginning, a geographic entity and a cultural entity, but also a political entity. And therefore, the British or colonial bond claim that, you know, it was the British which created India as a nation doesn't stand. Just look at this map, it doesn't work. There was one political entity, and this is the largest that it will ever reach. Later on, and I'm going to very, very quickly pass over a few slides, you will see a succession of empires. Details do not matter for us today at all. It's only to say that these empires will try to recreate this almost complete integration of India. They will never succeed. They will never come back to the level of the Mauryan Empire for all kinds of reasons. There will be too much fragmentation. But this desire at the back of the Indian political mind to politically integrate the whole of India will remain. And this is what you see even in stories like Mahabharata, for example. Remember the four Pandavas going to the four directions of India to conquer all territory for Yudhishthira, who will become the ruler of the whole region, so of the whole land rather. So this desire is very conscious in the India. This is Ashoka, who rules over this huge empire. And now we have this concept of Chakravartin. Chakravartin is what? It is of course a word for the emperor, but it means whose wheels are moving. But it also means the wheel of Dharma. There is a pun here. Chakra is both the wheel of the government, the wheels of the government, but it is also the wheel of Dharma, because Ashoka, for reasons that we will see tomorrow perhaps, Ashoka is concerned with the Buddhist Dharma and to propagate it. So here you can see all the emblems. You can see, for example, this pillar here in the background, very interesting. You can see the wheel quite clearly depicted, and other emblems like the horse, and I think there is an elephant here. So these are animals which will always be used as symbols of royalty and political power in India. In fact, we have very few depictions of Ashoka, very, very few. Somehow he did not, there was no concept as yet to, you know, promote the image of the king or the ruler or the emperor in a big way. So the early rulers of India never wanted to depict themselves too much. And these are exceptional banners from Kanaganahalli in northern Karnataka, which were actually identified quite recently. So as I said, he puts all his edicts on pillars or on rocks, which will be carved, and they cover pretty much the whole geography of India, minus the extreme south. Even in Afghanistan, there are a few edicts. But of course, the concentration is more in this region because his empire emerges from Pataliputra. This is another one in Bihar, with again the line at the top. Next, I will not spend time on this. I just want to show you very quickly, you can actually see it visually, what happens after the Mauryan Empire collapses, because it will collapse not long after Ashoka's death, is that we have first of all the Shunga Empire. Then this will be juxtaposed with the Satavahana Empire and then the Kalinga here. And we will have the kingdoms in the south. So in the east we have, this Karavela or Kalinga Empire. Karavela was a very mighty king. I mention him because he left those who can visit Bhubaneswar, do not miss it, in the Khandagiri Hills near Bhubaneswar. He left a colossal inscription which is more than 3 meters wide, where he lists all his military campaigns and how he tried to conquer region after region, and you can see his empire was not small. But what's very interesting is that he's a Jain king. And he, in fact, boasts that he brings back the images of the Tirthankas that he has reconquered from other regions and brought them back to his capital, Kalinga. And so you can see that Jain kings, even though Jainism swears by Ahimsa, Jain kings obviously were not bound to the concept of Ahimsa because they were also engaged in warfare. Then we will have the Kushan Empire, brought from, the Kushanas were coming from Central Asia. I mean, all these empires were very considerable in size, but they never came back to the level of the Mauryan Empire. For the first time, we have now rulers who start portraying themselves. This could be a Greek influence. It is possible, because the Greeks, the Greek kings and emperors were also constantly, Alexander the Great, you have so many depictions of him. So for the first time here, this is Kanishka, unfortunately without his head, decapitated by some successor we don't know. But you can see the boots which point to his non-Indian origin, Central Asian origin. And on coins also, I was telling you about currency, this is the first time when coins are going to depict kings, but not always, they will also continue to depict gods. And this coin is particularly interesting. This is a coin of Kanishka, because on one side you have Helios, that is to say the Greek sun god, you know, like Surya. But on the other side you have the Buddha. You can read. This is Beta, Omega, Delta, Delta, Omega. This is the Buddha, Buddha. So the Kushanas came as invaders. They were not Buddhists, we don't know, I don't know what their religion was. They were not interested initially in any of the Indian religions, but they were absorbed by Indian culture. And they became the major promoters of Buddhism in Central Asia, back in Central Asia. And this is one evidence for it. But you can see the influence from the Greek world. So it goes on. Finally, we come to the Gupta Empire, which was perhaps the largest after the Mauryan Empire. And again, this desire to recreate a political unity for the whole of India. Except, of course, a big chunk of the south is missing. And this will last for something like approximately 300 years. So these empires are risen, I mean, are fairly short-lived. But during such an empire, quite a huge number of activities, especially in the literary, scientific, technological, artistic production, will take place. And this will leave its mark at the cultural level. Now, I will conclude with a few points which we can get from the literature as well as inscriptions. We have seen so far some of the systems. We have seen broadly this twin desire to integrate politically India, but also to keep democratic institutions at work. Now, what do the texts like Arthashastra tell us about how a king is supposed to rule? So part of it I'll present now, and part of it tomorrow in the field of ethics. Kautilya says, first of all, this is very important for students of political science. He defines what is a state. He tells us what exactly a state consists of. And this is very, thoughtful of him, because it means he doesn't take the definition of a state for granted. You see, he feels the need to define it. And he defines it through saptanga, which means seven limbs. A state has seven constituents. The first is the king, but the king is not Raja, he's called Swami. So this tells us something about the ethical value attached to, you know, what the king should be. He is Swami. Then you have Amatya. Amatya are the ministers. That is pretty plain. Then you have a Janapada, as you say, territory. If you don't have a territory, again, you can't have a state. Durga. Durga means fortification. This is a time of warfare. Well, Kautilya is normally associated to the Mauryan Empire, even though some scholars want him to be much later, but it doesn't matter much for us. We can still keep him with the Mauryan Empire because he mentions specifically the Nanda Empire, which he hates and which he says he wants to help destroy, which happens under the Mauryan Empire. So anyway, whatever period he belongs to, this is a time of warfare. And therefore, you need to defend your territory. And you, if you do not have proper defense, you will not be able to maintain your state. Number five, kosha, treasury. So this is where artha comes in. You need wealth and a good, healthy economy. Otherwise, you will not be, and this Kautilya specifically mentions, otherwise you will not be able to pay your army. And if you can't pay your army, it's going to rebel. And therefore, the whole state is going to collapse, which historically happened, you know, a few times now and then. Danda. Danda is, at various levels, the authority of the ruler, or it can also be security and police. It works at all levels, a very general term. Finally, people say that it's all about warfare, but Kautilya is very realistic, very pragmatic. And he knows that you can't keep waging war all the time. You also need allies. You need dependable allies so that you can have a certain amount of safety, security, without expending your resources always in warfare. Because war is a costly affair. So sometimes you also need peace. He's not particularly a peace lover, and he's absolutely not a pacifist. There's no doubt about it. But he also doesn't want war unnecessarily. War is primarily intended to expand the territory. This is what Kautilya expects. Then he lists certain duties for the king. The first duty, and this is most important because this sets a standard for the whole of India. And this standard will be repeated again and again. It is already present in Bhishma's advice to Yudhishthira, which I mentioned earlier. The same thing is said in Mahabharata. But it is something which most rulers will at least pretend or claim that they also share as an ideal. Whether they practice it or not is a completely different issue. At least the ideal is set. And he says in the happiness of his subjects lies his happiness. The king can be happy only if the subjects are happy. So this is something very progressive, extremely progressive for those times. It is not about having brutal, militarily enforced rule. Whatever pleases himself, he shall not consider as good. But whatever pleases his subjects, he shall consider as good. So the king's duty is to ensure the subjects' happiness. And this will be echoed in one of the edicts of Ashoka. We'll see a few more tomorrow, where he says, all men are my children. You see, after Ashoka's conversion to Buddhism, he suddenly developed a kind of sympathy for humanity. And he said, what I desire for my own children, that is his biological children now he's referring to, and for my biological children, and I desire their welfare and happiness, both for in this world and the next, that I desire for all men. So he wants all humanity to be happy, which is a direct echo of Kotila. Kotila continues, and he tells that the king should tell the army. He says the king must tell the army, I'm a paid servant like yourselves. This is what he must tell his soldiers. This country is to be enjoyed by me together with you. So there is no question here, and this is important, again, of an absolute monarch. Absolute monarchy is pretty much a European concept. It was in practice in the Middle Ages to some extent. Of course, it's always relative. But in India, the idea was that the king was basically a trustee. He was not someone who could do as he pleased. Then he says, from his granary, the king should set apart one half for the people in the countryside in times of distress and use the other half. And he should replace old stock with new. This is very important again. It shows us how the king has, if he is really serious about the welfare of his subjects, he must plan for times of drought, for times of natural calamities, even for times of warfare. And therefore he should always reserve half of his wealth, which often is got out of taxes. He should reserve that for the welfare of people in distress. Traders, this is interesting, shall declare the quantity and price of the goods that have arrived at the foot of the flag before the city gate. I don't know if you recall in my talk on civic architecture, I insisted a lot on the city gates and the narrowed entrances into the city. And this is exactly what is depicted here. So the traders come, they reach the city gate, and they declare the goods, the quantity and the price. If there is a competition among buyers, the increase in price, because if there are more buyers, the price is going to shoot up. Now, this increase in price, together with the duty, shall go to the treasury. It is not allowed for a trader to make more money out of speculation, simply because artificially the price goes up. If the trader declares the quantity of the goods or the price to be less than it actually is, so as to lower the duty, say you are a trader and you declare that you sold your rice at 10 rupees when you actually sold it at 30, this allows you to pay lesser taxes, right? Well, then the king shall confiscate the difference, all the traders shall pay 8 times the duty. So very heavy fines. And Kotila Arthashastra, I don't have time to continue, is full of such rules to ensure transparency, equitability. There should be some sense of justice, of fairness. Fairness to everyone. Fairness to various sections of the society, to the traders, to the common people, fairness to women. There are lots of laws to protect women, especially. He is very concerned with all this. So this is what makes Arthashastra such an interesting document, if you know how to read it properly. And this, I think, we can skip. These are simply inscriptions which, in different kingdoms, and these are historical inscriptions, you can see the dates, all 8th, 9th century, and so on, which actually reflect these values, which are spelled out by the texts, by Ashoka in his edicts, by Kautilya, and so on. They all the kings claim or want, you know, to be remember as having promoted dharma. For example, this one, this Pallava ruler says he is ruling the earth according to dharma, even in the Kali age, even in the Kali era when there is no dharma left, he still stands for dharma. So you see that these values, whether this is true or not, is absolutely no way we can tell. But the claim is there, so at least the concept is there, and this is important. This also goes on. I think skip. You can see that these are all the duties of the king. This is an important text, Mana Solasa, of the 12th century, which is all about rules for the king, how to govern, how not to govern. So this is, you can simply have a glance at it. This is sufficient. But there are 20 rules listed for the, I'm sorry, I went a bit too fast, for the kings to follow. So a lot of ideas are set in front of the rulers. If they want to depart from these ideas, well, they will have a bad name. This is what is implied. Tiruvalluvar also, the Quran of Tamil literature, I think you can read by yourselves later on these very interesting texts. In fact, I will circulate also a certain number of primary sources of this kind, which are very easy to read, very enjoyable, and which tell us about the models which were in front of the rulers. This is my final slide, and I will again not read it out. You can read it out later. This is by Basham, A.L. Basham, who is a very fine Indologist, and wrote a book called The Wonder That Was India. And in this book, he assesses, he's quite a critical person. He's not a unconditional admirer of India, far from it.
And he doesn't hesitate to, you know, dwell on the dark spots in Indian history or society. But overall, he finds that despite all these inequalities, social inequalities as we know, in no other civilization were slaves so few in number, and in no other ancient law book are their rights so well protected as in the Arthashastra. No other ancient lawgiver proclaimed such noble ideals of fair play in battle, you know, the Kshatriya code, as did Manu. In all her history of warfare, and this is that I want to read, Hindu India has few tales to tell. Cities put to the sword, which is what Alexander the Great, for example, did when he invaded Sindh. Entire cities, populations were massacred. And we have this from the Greek historians themselves. This does not happen in the Indian context. Or of the massacre of non-combatants. The ghastly sadism of the kings of Assyria, who flayed their captives alive, is completely without parallel in ancient India. There was sporadic cruelty and oppression, no doubt. But in comparison with conditions in other early cultures, it was mild. To us, the most striking feature of ancient Indian civilization is its humanity. So this is an estimate by an outsider, who is again not particularly well disposed, but who looks at the totality of Indian history.